What's so important?
Well, they're here.
End times, kid. End times.
When most people think about UFOs or UFO sightings, they think about it in terms of our time. But what about the past? Were other generations witnessing strange lights in the sky?
Strange sights appeared in the skies long before spaceflight or manned flight of any kind was possible. And in each century, these visions took on identities that tell much about the worldview of those who saw them. Alexander the Great and his army, for instance, were harassed by a pair of flying objects in 329 BC. Most of the soldiers fled the scene, but some of the hardier men stood their ground and tried to hit the discs with their arrows and with stones from their slings. In 1492, just 4 hours before discovering land, Christopher Columbus saw a bright glowing object come out of the sky, go into the water, and travel slowly through the water very close to the ship that he was on. Engraved onto a French token, minted in the 1860s, is a disc-shaped flying object that experts say may have commemorated a daytime UFO sighting. The great British astronomer, Edmund Halley, of Comet fame, also saw a series of unexplained aerial objects in March of 1716. One of them lit up the sky for more than 2 hours and was so brilliant that Halley could read a printed text by its light. There were sightings in 1897 of a lighter-than-air ship that had propellers, porthole windows, and brilliant searchlights, which it directed at the ground. In 1917, what may have been the largest crowd ever to witness a UFO occurred in Fatima, Portugal. 50,000 people watched in amazement as a huge silver disc began spinning like a windmill and dancing about in the sky. After plunging toward the earth, it climbed back into the sky and disappeared into the sun. One night during the summer of 1948, Clyde W. Tombaugh, the astronomer who discovered the planet Pluto, was sitting in the back of his home at Las Cruces, New Mexico. He and several witnesses, including other members of his family, watched a strange glowing craft move overhead. All of the witnesses agreed that the object was definitely a solid ship and that it was probably some form of extraterrestrial device. John Keel is a world-renowned expert on UFOs and has written numerous books and articles on the subject. A self-described agnostic, he made this statement. Thousands of books have been written on the subject of demonology, which is the ancient and scholarly study of monsters and demons. The manifestations and occurrences described in this literature are identical to the UFO phenomenon. Victims of demonic possession suffer from the same medical and emotional symptoms as the UFO contactees. Dr. Jacques Vallée has addressed the United Nations on UFOs and was the model for Lacombe in Steven Spielberg's Close Encounters of the Third Kind. He is the author of 8 books on UFOs and has been widely recognized as the premier investigating scientist in the realm of UFO research. In his book, Messengers of Deception, Vallée says, an impressive parallel can be made between UFO occupants and the popular conception of demons. And in his book, Confrontations, he writes, the medical examinations to which abductees are said to be subjected, often accompanied by sadistic sexual manipulation, is reminiscent of the medieval tales of encounters with demons. He also made this statement, I believe that when we speak of UFO sightings as instances of space visitations, we are looking at the phenomenon on the wrong level. We are not dealing with successive waves of visitations from space. We are dealing with a control system. And he states, UFOs are the means through which man's concepts are being rearranged. They are engaging in a worldwide enterprise of subliminal seduction.
I found this old book that was published in 1970 that has some very intriguing information printed in it. A lot of the stories I'm about to read to you have been lost to history. Until now, that is. 1893. In Wales, some 8 or 10 lights were seen at times, gyrating through the sky in astounding fashion, going up and down rapidly, then zigzagging, all in perfect formation, like a fleet of airships. 1887. If a ball of fire falls into the sea, it can be called a meteor. But what if a ball of flame rises up out of the sea? Such was witnessed by the bug-eyed crew aboard the British steamer Siberian on November 12th of that year. The object rose to a height of 50 feet over the water, darted close to the ship, then sped away, out of sight. Ships were a prime source of UFO sightings in the 19th century. One of the most repeated phenomena reported by 24 ships or more was typified by the following account. May 15th, 1879. Commander Pringle of the HMS Vulture of the Persian Gulf put in his log that two incredible objects were pacing his ship, both submerged but glowing brightly. On looking towards the east, he wrote, the appearance was that of a revolving wheel, whose spokes were illuminated, and, looking to the west, a similar wheel appeared to be revolving in the opposite direction. 1845. Substantiating the above, the brig Victoria, on June 18th in the Mediterranean, came upon three luminous bodies that rose silently and mysteriously out of the sea, remaining within sight for some 10 minutes in the air in slow maneuvers. 1883. An inexplicable phenomenon witnessed by thousands of people on both the Canadian and American sides as a UFO shaped like a square table hovered above Niagara Falls for 1 hour. May 15th, 1811. The people of Geneva, Switzerland saw an aerial show never before seen. It was an odd UFO, one that seemed to change shape from a glowing serpent to a horseshoe and to a crescent. August 10th, 1809. John Staveley of London perhaps witnessed the first authentic appearance of a mothership and its attendant saucers. Although he hardly recognized it as such, I saw many meteors coming around the edge of a black cloud, from which lightning flashed. They were like dazzling specks of light dancing and traipsing through the clouds. November 17th, 1882. At the Royal Observatory in Greenwich, England, was observing an aurora display when a greenish blob crossed his field of vision. Some adjustment of his focus resolved the object into a cigar shape that passed above the moon. It appeared to be a definite body, Maunder said flatly. September 7, 1820, during an eclipse of the moon, several astronomers reported the same thing, strange objects moving in straight lines, evenly spaced, that crossed the face of the moon slowly and made turns in military precision. August 12, 1883. This is one of the most famous and baffling of all the astronomical UFOs observed. Professor Jose Bonilla, director of the Astronomical Observatory at Zacatecas, Mexico, was recording sunspots when suddenly a small luminous body began crossing the disk of the sun. No sooner had he gotten over his first surprise than another such body appeared, then another, and another, and more. In the space of 2 hours, he said, I counted up to 283 bodies crossing the solar disk. These UFO sightings don't just stop in the 1800s. You can trace them all the way back through history. 1551 AD, red rods were seen above Lisbon, Portugal, floating and flying through the sky. 1387 AD, in England, a burning revolving wheel was seen also around a barrel of flame. 1254 AD, in the sky appeared a kind of large ship, elegantly shaped and well equipped, and of marvelous color.
It was red and yellow and green and brown and scarlet and black.
1168 AD, a globe of fire was seen moving to and fro in the air. 919 AD, a thing like a burning torch cruised in the sky, and glistening balls sailed over Hungary. 1577 AD, an object like a lance passed across the sky. 98 AD, in Italy, another burning torch was observed, probably quite like the flaming red ball-shaped UFOs seen today. 12 AD, in old Irish manuscripts, There's one tale very likely based on truth. Ancient Erie, Ireland. An anchor suddenly dropped from the sky and hooked itself into a church steeple. The townspeople then saw a ship in the sky with men aboard. One man climbed down the cable as if to free the anchor, and his motion was like that of a man swimming in water. Some of the watching men wanted to dash up to the steeple and capture the skyman, but the bishop forbade them. The strange being returned to his craft without finishing his job, but they cut the cable and the vessel vanished into the sky. Now, there are thousands of more UFO reports that date back to the beginning of time. But what about actual evidence? As reported in the Scientific American in 1851, rock was being blasted apart in a New England community. Among the shattered stone debris was found a metallic vessel broken in two. When placed together, they formed a bell-shaped chalice about 4.5 inches high and 6.5 inches wide. Made of zinc impregnated with silver, there are intricate flower designs all over it inlaid in silver. It came from 15 feet down in solid rock, reported in 1845 and still existing. Is a nail of obvious manufacture that was found in a stone block from the Kindgoody Quarry in North Britain. The nail was half embedded in stone, half in till, which is the crumbly matter churned up by the glacial ages. If the nail originally rested in a solid stone, it is millions of years old. Again in a quarry in 1844, near Tweed, England, workmen discovered gold thread encased 8 feet beneath the surface of the stone bed. In 1851, another cut iron nail, sixpenny size and only slightly corroded, fell out when a man dropped a piece of auriferous quartz. In 1833, they found a coin 30 feet deep in the ground, and it was about the size of a shilling. Despite the long burial, the markings were distinct, representing a warrior or a hunter of Roman appearance, but no Roman coins of that type were ever struck. In 1891, Mrs. Culp of Morrisonville, Illinois, was shoveling coal into her kitchen stove when a large lump broke in two. Exposed to her astonished view was an intricate gold chain, as finely worked as anything jewelers can make today. In Salzburg, Austria, and now in museum, a block of coal from the Miocene strata yielded a perfectly machined cube of steel with slightly convex but symmetrical top and bottom sides, with a cut groove running precisely all around its middle. Examined by dozens of scientists, technicians, and steel experts, all of them declared it could not be possibly natural and was positively artificial. An artifact made by the hands of human or otherwise.
But apparently, just recovered are off-world vehicles not made on this Earth. That's a direct quote.
The Universal Story agrees with the record of every major culture of the ancient world in which the astonishingly consistent story is told of gods that descended from heaven and or came through spiral vortices to materialize in bodies of flesh. From Rome to Greece, and before that to Egypt, Persia, Assyria, Babylonia, Sumer, the earliest records of civilization tell of the era when powerful beings known to the Hebrews as watchers, and in the book of Genesis as the Bnei HaElohim, the sons of God, mingled themselves with humans, giving birth to part celestial, part terrestrial hybrids known as Nephilim. The Bible says this happened when men began to increase on earth and daughters were born to them. When the sons of God saw the women's beauty, and they took wives from among them to sire their unusual offspring. I believe a record of this is recorded in Genesis 6:4, when it says there were giants in the earth in those days, and also after that, when the sons of God came in unto the daughters of men, and they bare children to them. The same became mighty men which were of old, men of renown. This is Dr. Thomas Horn, and you are watching End Times Productions.
What's beneath us?
The ancient ones. The gods that used to rule the earth.
During research for our best-selling book, On the Path of the Immortals, I was given the unprecedented opportunity, really, to sit down with and to film Dr. Don Mose Jr., a third-generation medicine man who I met with for a large part of a day And he told me the oldest legends of the Anasazi, which he had been told by his great-grandfather, who likewise had been told by his ancestors, which included stories of the Anasazi turning to sorcery, to sacrifice, cannibalism, after they had lost their way and were driven insane by a reptilian creature, which they depict with a halo above his head, of all things. Images of that being are, by the way, included in the petroglyphs that we filmed inside the canyons. And I believe that they likely attest to the fallen reptile or reptiles of biblical fame, which also misled humanity. As I said in the traditional Hogan at one of the Navajo schools Dr. Don Mose teaches at, he began drawing in the sand on the floor and reciting the first part of the story of the ancient Anasazi and how it had been repeated to him by his father and grandfather, who had also been told by their ancestors and so on, a legend that Dr. Mose alone had undoubtedly repeated hundreds of times before at the Navajo school. Now, since it was obvious to us that this Navajo historian was really indifferent to our camera and our recording plans, and in fact, I could tell he was really uncomfortable with us putting him on film, but thankfully, he let us proceed nevertheless. But I sat there and listened respectfully as he proceeded for nearly 2 hours to describe to this white man what's only ever been allowed a few times in history before, and that is the legendary stories of creation, of giants, of a great flood, of a reptilian deceiver, all from the voice of the nation's top medicine man. Dr. Mose even sang to us in the antiquated tongue of what I would call Old Testament history, paralleled in their earliest antiquity using the Navajo language. Now, not only did Dr. Mose substantiate the age-old and globally recorded story of those who come through portals and the impact that they have had on biblical and global history, past and present, not only did he weave Navajo Indian myths and legends seamlessly with our understanding of the 6 days of creation, the arrival of the Nephilim, and their connection to judgment by a global flood, followed by the repopulating of people around the world, and then a second incursion of the giants. But there were several instances in which, when I pushed Dr. Mose for greater detail, he would go off script, actually delineating from the official Navajo storyline to provide greater consistency between history and the way the Bible itself recorded certain events.
This is part of a ritual.
A ritual sacrifice?
As Mose was following the official storyline, the one that you would get from the Parks Department in the four corners of the U.S., about how the Anasazi didn't disappear, but rather they slowly migrated out of the area and became the modern Pueblo Indians, I expressed doubts to Dr. Mose about that story. And he responded by grinning just a little bit and saying, "Well, I probably shouldn't tell you this, but," and then he proceeded to tell us the older stories that his grandfather had repeated about these mysterious people actually disappearing after they came under mind control from a reptile with a halo, this carnivorous creature, suspiciously similar to what I later described in the Path of the Immortals book as fiery seraphim, which comes from the Hebrew seraph, the Hebrew Old Testament, fiery serpent, which also corresponds with a lot of other testaments around the ancient world, including the Sanskrit sarpa or sarpine, which means reptile, and so on. Now, another case in point is when I told Dr. Mose what we had learned from the Apache about cannibalistic giants and then God destroying them in a flood. And he looks right into the camera and he says, "Oh, yes." And then he reaches over and he picks up this illustrated book that he had authored that's used in the Navajo Nation schools and libraries. And he opened to show us an artist depiction of a giant that had stood between 30 and 40 feet tall. And then he starts saying there was this time when the earth was infested with such great giants and alien gods that came down and destroyed and ate the people. Some of them were in human form. Others, he said, were monsters like human-animal hybrids, which I think the Old Testament also describes. And then he followed that story with the famous Navajo legend of the White Shell Woman, who gave birth to two of the most important characters in Navajo mythology, the twin miracle-performing sons, one of whose names literally translates Slayer of Alien Gods, and his twin brother. And together, those two great warriors killed many of the giants, hybrids, and the monsters that were destroying mankind. As Dr. Mose described these ancient tales, I couldn't help but think of David killing Goliath, and then later other giants with his mighty men. Then there was a point where Mose paused and he said, you know, when the Christian missionaries first came to America and told our people their stories of the giants and the great flood, he said, we smiled and let them know that we already knew these stories, that they had been told to us long ago by our own ancestors. After a week on the road, having covered hundreds of miles of reservations, to walk amidst their multiple ruins, including hogans, temples, kivas, to follow guides and visit with a medicine man, not to mention tracking down and photographing petroglyphs, we were finally on our way to the last site that we were going to visit, one that our Cherokee guide had told us not to miss. We already collected enough pictogram and logogram images from ancient rock engravings throughout the Four Corners area to make our case and to calculate for our purposes a recurring theme, which definitely seemed to match the Middle Eastern and biblical stories of portals, reptilians, fallen angels, giants, and the havoc that those creatures had played on the old world. But this final petroglyph that was important, our guide had said, and one that we could drive right up to. So we decided to make one final excursion, this time into Utah, 50 miles north of Moab, where one of the largest known collections of petroglyphs is located in the San Juan County. This storyboard that we would visit there was etched in sandstone as early as 1,000 years before Christ. And it records practically every element contained in the Bible and extra-biblical texts involving spiral vortices and those who come through them, including human-animal chimeras and even giant six-fingered and six-toed footprints in pursuit of much smaller five-fingered and five-toed humans. Even that reptilian that Dr. Don Mose had described to us with its halo was drawn there, just a couple of feet away from the alien-looking bug-eyed creatures. This location is also easier to get to than most of the ones that we trekked to, yet it's as important, if not more so, than any petroglyphs you could spend days hiking over miles of rough terrain to reach. It's called the Newspaper Rock Petroglyph. And is somewhat decipherable as to which images are older due to the fading and darkness of the earlier depictions, which are certainly the most mysterious with their alien-looking creatures and suits and what might even be some type of a flying craft. And archaeologists believe the writing on this great wall continued from 1,000 years before Christ or earlier up until about AD 1300. The same time that the Anasazi suddenly disappeared. The Anasazi used images and symbols similar to those found globally that connect to a first and second incursion of giants and the mountainous gateways that those creators came through. Now, that being true, if you take only the images that the Anasazi left behind and compare them to similar, in some cases identical, universal symbols found elsewhere around the world where the stories and meanings of the images have been made clear, and keeping in mind that these legends materialized globally at approximately the same time, when the Torah, that is Genesis through Deuteronomy, the first five books of the Bible, was written around BC 1300, this would have been the same time when archaeologists believe the Anasazi, across the world from these Bible lands, were drawing giant, six-toed footprints on a slab wall in Utah and facing an alien enemy, as the name Anasazi implies. When the writings in the Torah are compared with other ancient texts, including Enoch, Jubilees, Baruch, Genesis Apocryphon, Philo, Josephus, Jasher, Jubilees, and many others, not counting the accounts of the American Indian tribes on this side of the world, it's clear that this is more than a legend. It is history. It's a chronicle told through different people's methods and worldviews involving giants suddenly infesting the entire world and then being wiped out in a flood, then somehow returning in a second incursion. This story was written down globally, from Hebrew scrolls to Indian petroglyphs, to provide the oldest recorded testament of part human, part angelic creatures who were in turn the offspring of hideous reptilian entities, or what the apocryphal book of Enoch calls fallen watchers. In the beginning, the great creator made everything. Then powerful reptilians came down from heaven through portals, the spiral, halo, and reptilian symbols that we found in the petroglyphs. They came to deceive the world, as Dr. Don Mose told us, and the world fell into darkness. This is also hinted in one of the meanings of the word Anasazi, which can literally be translated, according to the experts that we discussed this with, as an alien enemy. Portals, represented in ancient spiral symbolism, besides giant six-toed footprints and horned humanoid figures, opened at this time, and alien gods or monsters and giants came through them. Some of these giants had six fingers and six toes, just as described in the Old Testament. Then the Creator destroyed the monsters and giants in a great flood. And yet the giants and reptilian deceivers returned. They turned to sorcery, to cannibalism, and human sacrifice.
At least one of them was part of an archaeological dig. It's old. At least one of them is old. I don't know if it was the one I worked on, but I remember something to do with an archaeological dig. That means it's not just old, it's ancient.
But what does that mean? It's actually more simple than you might think. What you're about to hear is the very best explanation I've ever heard. It's from my interview with Timothy Alberino.
What we have in the Genesis 6 affair are extraterrestrial interlopers who are descending to the earth from some extraterrestrial realm. And they're likely descending to the earth on the summit of Mount Hermon, almost assuredly at the helm of advanced aerospace vehicles. In other words, they're showing up in what we would call UFOs, perhaps even saucers. And there's this misconception that angels have wings, and that when they picture these angelic beings, these watchers descending to the earth, that they're flapping their wings and they're landing like storks or something like that, which is complete nonsense. The watchers showed up in advanced aerospace vehicles, and they had high technology with them. The technology is probably many, many centuries more advanced. It's important to understand that when we talk about the Watchers, what we are referring to is an angelic race of beings. This is a race. And when I say the elder race, I am in fact referencing the angels, those beings. And when we think about those beings, the elder race, We should not be thinking about quote-unquote spiritual beings, ethereal beings with wings who just transport themselves around by magic, basically, or flap their wings, and, you know, are these, again, these very ethereal creatures. Rather, we should think about angels, and this is a biblical perspective. This is not a sci-fi perspective. This is a biblical perspective. We should think about angels as extraterrestrial beings. They are extraterrestrial. The term extraterrestrial simply means not from the earth, a provenance other than the earth, an origin other than planet earth. Well, that's given. We know that that's the case within the biblical narrative, because the angels pre-existed the earth. The sons of God pre-existed the earth. So they're obviously not from the earth. They're not earthborn. We are earthborn, and the Nephilim are also earthborn. That's part of what the term means. Earthborn. That's part of what the term in Greek for giant means. Earthborn. So we are specifically earthborn. Our provenance is planet Earth. Angels are not earthborn. Their provenance is not planet Earth. They are from elsewhere in the universe. They are therefore, by definition, extraterrestrial. Terrestrial meaning Earth. They are extraterrestrial. They are from elsewhere in the cosmos. They are also alien. They are not human. So they also fit the description of alien. These are not anti-biblical terms. These are accurate terms that correctly define these beings. They are extraterrestrial, and they are alien to the human species. And they are in possession of advanced technology, including advanced aerospace vehicles, i.e. UFOs, what we call UFOs. So they have knowledge. They have more knowledge of the universe than we do. That means they have more knowledge pertaining to chemistry, pertaining to physics, pertaining to mathematics, pertaining to astronomy. Much more knowledge than we do. And they have derived much more advanced technological implements than we have. Number one, this race, the elder race, has been around a lot longer than us. Mankind was created to be a little lower than the heavenly beings and the angels. So biologically speaking, cognitively and physically, our physiology is lesser than theirs. Their physiology is greater than ours. In other words, biologically speaking, they are superior to us. Without their technology, just biologically speaking, they are superior to us. They are a superior race. But then when you throw in their knowledge and their technology, they are also far more technologically advanced than we are. Angels are not traversing the heavens in horse-drawn chariots. Horses don't fly. They're not like Santa Claus flying through the sky, you know, with a sled being pulled by reindeer. Angels are navigating the heavens in advanced aerospace vehicles, in saucers and the other UFOs. But they're not the only ones. So my perspective of the antediluvian world, the world before the flood, is a little bit different than a lot of other people's perspective. I don't imagine this world in which you just have mankind becoming very wicked and degenerate and committing all kinds of offenses against God. And then God just is angry with mankind because of his sin and sends a flood. The story is much more intricate than that. And quite frankly, much more interesting. What we have is a scenario in which the Watchers were the living gods walking among men. And their hybrid offsprings happened to be giants. And these giants were oppressing mankind. And as I said, because they were human hybrid offspring, because they were human watcher hybrids, they had legal authority through the birthright of Adam. They had legal authority to govern the earth. And because they were giants, It was not difficult for them to overthrow every human potentate. It was the perfect plan, if you think about it, from the Watchers. How do we ensure that our human hybrid offspring can take dominion of the Earth? Well, that wouldn't be very difficult if they were all giants. A league of giants who would have been looked at as demigods and worshipped. And the Watchers would have been worshipped as gods walking among men. And this was the scenario unfolding in the Earth before the Flood. And so you had the gods who were manifest. You had their hybrid offspring who were giants. They took dominion of the Earth. And the gods, according to to Greek mythology and to the mythologies of many ancient civilizations, the gods, the Greeks say that the gods apportioned among themselves the Earth. They apportioned the Earth among themselves. They divided it up, and they each became the rulers of their own kingdoms. And of course, I believe that the Greek mythology regarding the gods is a reference to the history regarding the Watchers, the true history of the Watchers and their hybrid sons. And so the Watchers set up a global empire, and each of them had their own kingdom, and their kingdoms were governed by their sons, again, who were human enough to legally govern the Earth. They usurped the dominion of mankind, and mankind was oppressed. They were living under the worst dystopia you can imagine. The giants, and according to the Book of Enoch, men were required to feed the giants, to sustain them. And so, I don't know how many giants there were, but they were forcing the human inhabitants of the Earth to feed them, to sustain them, and probably were bringing sacrifices and worshiping their fathers, the Watchers, and prostrating before their hybrid sons, who were the kings over these empires, these giants. And eventually, when mankind could no longer satisfy the appetites of the giants began to devour mankind, to devour men. And so it became this dystopic nightmare on Earth, in which not only was mankind working, slaving to provide food and sustenance for the giants, they then became the food. And it's likely in my mind that the Watchers were requiring of mankind human sacrifices that were to be brought to their hybrid sons. In other words, that, you know, each village or each city would have to produce human beings who would be brought to be consumed, to be devoured by the giants. And so this is a nightmarish scenario unfolding on the Earth before the Flood. It wasn't just that mankind was really sinful. It was that mankind was being devoured. Mankind was going to war with one another and killing and slaughtering each other in these massive wars that were taking place before the Flood, and every kind of perversion and evil and corruption was rampant on Earth, yes. But at the same time, you have the Watchers and their giant sons who were devouring mankind and were governing the Earth. And so the Earth was usurped from the offspring of Adam, from the sons of Adam. And it's very interesting, because both in the Book of Genesis and also in the Enochian account, there's this phrase, and I'm going to get it wrong, so I'll paraphrase it, and mankind began to call upon the name of the Lord, or something to that effect. And it's at that point that the decision is made to send the Flood. Why? Because you have the regents of the Earth, mankind, whose authority, whose dominion was usurped by the hybrid sons of the Watchers, beginning to petition heaven. They're petitioning heaven. So this is like it's a response, it's a judicial response from the great judge who's looking down at what's happening on the Earth. And in one sense, mankind was just reaping what he sowed. They struck this deal with the Watchers, and this is the result. And now they're suffering the consequences of their actions. But God has compassion. He hears the cry of mankind. He is sympathetic to the suffering that's happening on the earth as men are petitioning him for redress against the Watchers and their giant offspring. And God decides to intervene. And a judgment is pronounced from heaven, and God dispatches some angels to go and do various things. And what the angels do basically is one of them is charged with inciting the sons of the Watchers, the giants, to war with one another. And that's what happens. The giants go to war with one another. And so you can imagine these hybrid kingdoms ruled by these giants going to war with one another. This is what happened. And I don't think it was, you know, big stupid Disney giants with clubs on their shoulders.
Technology, right?
I think this was a war involving technology. These were kingdoms ruled by the giant hybrid sons of the Watchers going to battle with one another, very likely with kinetic weapons of war. Another angel is dispatched to seize the Watchers and to put them in chains and to force them to watch the destruction of their sons as they go to battle with one another. And so this is the redress from the King of Heaven. He's going to cause the giants to go to war with one another and annihilate each other. This is before the flood, to annihilate each other. And he's going to force their fathers, their angelic fathers, to watch the destruction of their beloved sons. And this is what's unfolding on the earth in the pre-flood world. So it's like, you know, it's like the Lord of the Rings or something. It's these massive battles happening and nation against nation, but these nations are governed by hybrid giants. And they utterly destroy each other. When we think about technology, high technology in the antediluvian world, I don't believe that all of civilization was in possession of high technology or of advanced knowledge. In fact, the Book of Enoch gives us hints as to what the situation really was. And that is that the Watchers taught mankind certain things. Certain things. They taught them how to make weapons of war and so forth. But they reserved the greater mysteries, the greater secrets for their sons, which is logical. If you want your sons to have supremacy, you're going to imbue them with better knowledge and with better technology so that they can maintain dominance over the rest of the population and also their wives. They also taught their wives. So the way that I look at the pre-flood world is rather than saying, well, there was an advanced civilization, the most accurate way to contemplate this situation is that we're dealing with something like a Bronze Age or an Iron Age civilization, generally speaking, but within this civilization was a fraternity of beings who were exceedingly advanced. And the best way to illustrate this, I think, is to reference the movie Stargate. Do you remember the original Stargate? Not the TV series, I never saw it, but the movie, the original Stargate with Kurt Russell, in which they go through this Stargate and they go to another planet. And on this planet, wherever it is, there is a Bronze Age civilization. They encounter a Bronze Age civilization that would be very much like the ancient Egyptians. Indeed, in that movie, it was the ancient Egyptians who were brought there. So it was this Bronze Age civilization. But who was ruling over this Bronze Age civilization? A technologically advanced extraterrestrial race. And this fraternity within this civilization was in possession of advanced technology, whereas the Bronze Age people had swords and whatever. This fraternity, this extraterrestrial fraternity, had these rods that were shooting plasma, and they could fly. Their pyramid was a ship or whatever. So that's the way that I contemplate the pre-flood world. You have a bronze or perhaps a Iron Age level civilization. That's the majority of the populace. They're worshiping the Watchers as gods, and they're prostrating before their giant sons as the potentates, the kings of the earth, and the sons and the wives of the Watchers, and the Watchers themselves are operating advanced technology. So the Watchers are flying around in saucers, and their sons are in possession of advanced technology, and their wives are in possession of advanced technology. These are gods among men. So when those kingdoms go to war with each other, it's a kinetic war. It's a war in which technology is being deployed. That's the way that I conceptualize the pre-flood world. Now, is that the way it really was? I don't know. But it doesn't make sense to me that there was a situation in which the masses of mankind were in possession of advanced technology. Why? Because we would find more evidence of that. And so this is the golden age of yore, which is referenced by every primary ancient culture on Earth in different ways, of course, with different terminology. But the premise is the same. This is the time in which the gods lived among men. It's called Zeptepi by the Egyptians. The first time when Osiris and Isis and the other gods of the Egyptians dwelt among men, it was a golden age in which the knowledge of the gods was proliferating, and the people were benefiting from the direct rule of these advanced extraterrestrial beings. And it was a time in which the hybrid offspring of the gods, because the gods in the golden age, one of the things that marks the golden age, that is iconic of the golden age, is the gods copulated with human women and produced the demigods, the hybrid sons of their union, the union of the gods with mortal women. And this defines the golden age. And of course, the golden age is viewed through a laudatory prism by every ancient culture on Earth, and laudatory meaning in a positive light. The golden age is viewed as this wonderful time, the best time the world has ever seen, by every ancient culture save one: the ancient Hebrews. The ancient Hebrews had the inverse of that perspective. They viewed the golden age as the worst time for humanity on Earth. It was a time in which mankind was subjugated to the offspring of the Watchers and was literally being devoured by them. It was a tyranny the likes of which we have never before seen, but we'll see again briefly at the end of the age. There are a lot of stories in mythologies that are symbolic of the Golden Age, and the one that is most familiar to us is the story of Atlantis. Atlantis, in my opinion, is an allegory of the antediluvian age. Now, I also believe Atlantis was a real city, but primarily it was an allegory. It serves as an allegory. Atlantis is a Greek story. Of course, it was related by Plato. And Atlantis was founded by Poseidon, who's one of the gods, the Olympian gods. Poseidon, the gods, just like in the Book of Enoch, the gods divided the earth among themselves, and they each took a portion. They were allotted a portion. And Poseidon, his portion was the region in which Atlantis was, but Atlantis wasn't there yet. He built it. He created it. So Poseidon established this island and created this city on the island called Atlantis. So Poseidon is the patron of Atlantis. But what did Poseidon do? He took a human woman as his wife. He copulated with her. She conceived and gave birth to five sets of hybrid twins, who other ancient records intimate that they were giants. And of course, the most famous among them was Atlas. And so Atlas and his five, and his other brothers, his other twin brothers, ruled over Atlantis, but not just the island of Atlantis, rather the empire of Atlantis. And so If you take the story of Atlantis as an allegory of the Golden Age in general, it's a perfect depiction of what all the gods did. And by gods, of course, we mean these angelic watchers, these extraterrestrial interlopers who took wives. Again, a legal transaction with mankind, with the sons of Cain. And allotted the earth into portions among themselves and established their own kingdoms. And their kingdoms were ruled by who? Their hybrid sons, because the Watchers were not authorized to govern the earth. They had to do it by proxy. They had to rule by proxy from behind the thrones of their hybrid sons. So again, Atlantis is a fitting allegory of the antediluvian age in general. And, but again, I happen to believe it was also a city, an actual city, within this empire, this hybrid empire. Artifacts of the Empire of the Gods, as I call it, referencing the antediluvian world, still exist on Earth. And it is possible, it's possible, as fantastical as it sounds, that some of their technological devices, maybe even including stargates, if stargates are in fact real, maybe even including stargates, can still be found on the Earth, perhaps deep underground or in very specific places. And furthermore, this is conspiratorial, and this is just my opinion, but I believe that those kind of artifacts have indeed been found and are basically within the purview of the militaries of the world, rather than being in the purview of, say, the Smithsonian or something. Those would be military assets. You know, if you find a Stargate or some kind of advanced technology, that doesn't go to the vault of the Smithsonian. That goes to the R&D department of the Pentagon.
Brown Horse, this is White Horse. Stand by for Salute Report 2-1. Over.
White Horse is Brown Horse. Stand by to copy.
Line Sierra, 2-0 personnel. Line Alpha, patrolling what appears to be a headquarters break. Line Lima, 3-8 Sierra.
Tuesday, April 29th, 2003. Roughly 2 months after U.S. forces invade Iraq, BBC News releases an article that is so strange it seems to go against the very nature of our reality. Now, in order to understand the true significance of this article, we need to take a journey back in time, all the way back to approximately 2,500 years before the birth of Christ, and to a place that we now know as modern-day Iraq. And it is here that we begin our story. Tales of supernatural beings can be found all over the ancient world. The Bible, the Book of Enoch, and the Book of Giants, as well as other ancient Jewish texts, all speak of an event where fallen angels descended to earth and fooled mankind with their knowledge of science, war, and beauty. It is also recorded that these fallen angels, or watchers as they are called in the ancient text, manipulated the genetics, the DNA of mankind, creating an actual race of giants, as well as other hideous monsters using animal DNA. Descriptions of these disgusting beasts can be found in the Book of Giants, which, by the way, was part of the Dead Sea Scrolls collection. Parallel to that, other ancient texts speak of the same exact event, except it's from the fallen angels, or the Watchers' perspective. In ancient Babylon and Mesopotamia, for example, the Watchers were seen as a good thing. They came to help mankind, and they showed people how to do cool things. And they also created a mighty race of giants, men of renown. However, biblical accounts reveal these things to be evil, fallen angels led by Lucifer himself, who want nothing less than the total destruction of mankind. Quote, according to Mesopotamian myth, there were 7 Apkallu before the flood and 4 afterward. The word Apkallu comes from the Sumerian Ab, meaning water, Gal, meaning big, and Lu, meaning man. They were considered only partly evil, occasionally dangerous, and capable of malicious witchcraft. They were chimeric in appearance, usually depicted as humanoid with wings, or sometimes as hybrid birdman or bizarre fishman creatures. The antediluvian Apkallu were divine, just like the Watchers. According to one story from the Babylonian period, the Epic of Ea, Ea was the god of pestilence and plague. Marduk banished the Apkallu to the Abzu as a punishment for provoking him to send the flood. Supernatural beings linked to a global flood who are afterward banished to the abyss? Sound familiar? Interestingly, the 4 Apkallu who appeared after the flood were only partly divine and could mate with humans. Again, like the Watchers, the last of the post-flood Apkallu, Lunana, who was 2/3 Apkallu, matches the status of Gilgamesh, who was described as being 2/3 divine and 1/3 human. On the cylinder seal, Gilgamesh is called Lord of the Upkalu and is elsewhere credited with bringing back great knowledge that existed before the Flood. Scholars who have made the connection between the Upkalu and the Watchers tend to interpret the way the Watchers are portrayed in Jewish literature from Second Temple period, like the Book of Enoch, at least partly as a Jewish response to the Babylonian captivity. It was believed that the Upkalu, though potentially dangerous, had preserved secret pre-flood knowledge prized by the pagan wizards of Babylon. To the Jews, however, such knowledge was evil, and the Watchers were portrayed accordingly in Enochian texts. End quote. So, we have one epic story seen through two different lenses. On the one hand, we have the creator of the universe, the God of the Bible, telling the story. He is saying, yes, these fallen Watchers are evil, and you need to avoid them at all costs. And on the other hand, we have the account from the Watchers themselves saying, hey, that little guy, referring to God, I wouldn't worry about that little guy.
How about that little fella?
Oh, that little guy. I wouldn't worry about that little guy.
Quote, scholars have known for years that there are parallels in the Mesopotamian legends and the biblical accounts of the patriarchs. Enoch is similar to an antediluvian king named Amenderanke, and Noah is variously called Unapistim in Babylon, Zisudara in Sumer, and Atrahasis in Akkad. But even those accounts are part of a fallen realm military campaign, a supernatural psyop. For example, the accounts from Mesopotamia portray Gilgamesh as a mighty warrior, a hero, two-thirds god and one-third man. He has adventures and slays monsters, notably Humbaba, the defender of the faraway cedar forest, who'd been assigned to terrorize humans by the god Enlil, who is Enki's brother. In the Second Temple Jewish account known as the Book of Giants, Gilgamesh was, himself, one of the gigantic offspring of the Watchers, as was Humbaba, the monster Gilgamesh set out to kill. This is how Gilgamesh was viewed by the Jews between the time of the Babylonian captivity and the birth of Jesus. Basically, he was one of the Nephilim. End quote. One of the Nephilim. In case you don't know what a Nephilim is, it's the unholy offspring between the fallen Watchers and a human woman. Yeah. Moving back to Gilgamesh, he was a giant, part supernatural being, part human, otherwise known as a Nephilim. Now, here's where it gets crazy. Scholars actually believe Gilgamesh existed. And not only that, this article from 2003 the BBC News put out says they may have actually found his tomb. Quote, Gilgamesh tomb believed found. Archaeologists in Iraq believe they may have found the lost tomb of King Gilgamesh, the subject of the oldest book in history. The Epic of Gilgamesh, written by a Middle Eastern scholar 2,500 years before the birth of Christ, commemorated the life of the ruler of the city of Uruk, from which Iraq gets its name. Now, a German-led expedition has discovered what is thought to be the entire city of Uruk, including where the Euphrates once flowed, the last resting place of its famous king. I don't want to say definitely that it was the grave of King Gilgamesh, but it looks very similar to that described in the epic. Jörg Fassbinder of the Bavarian Department of Historical Monuments in Munich told the BBC World Service's Science in Action program, end quote. So, let's take a look at this in the big picture and see if anything makes sense, because as of now, this whole thing still remains a mystery. First off, the Bible says there will be a time when the Nephilim return. Some people believe this is a spiritual return by demonic possession. Others believe it's physically, as in a return of the giants. Fast forward 2,000 years, archaeologists find Gilgamesh's tomb in Iraq, 2 months after US forces take over the country. Is it possible that when news broke of the discovery of Gilgamesh's tomb, orders were given from the highest possible levels of government, and US troops arrived at the site to seal it off? DNA was collected from the skeleton and brought to a top secret underground research lab where tests were conducted, tests involving cloning technologies and CRISPR-Cas9. Of course, the only thing we can do is speculate. So what do you think about this? Do you think they really found Gilgamesh's tomb in 2003 as this article states? If so, what happened to it, and why is there no mention of the contents? Or maybe what they found was so insignificant that they thought all news coverage should just stop.
We're observing everything to the west of that MSR. Can you see the palm?
Does the deep state really exist? Mainstream society as a whole will be quick to tell you no. The deep state does not exist, and it is nothing more than a far-right conspiracy theory. Well, if it truly is a far-right conspiracy theory, then why did a Democrat, who also happened to be the President of the United States of America, not only seemingly confirm the existence of the deep state, but also suggests that they are the ones who are in charge of the UFO or UAP programs?
An official UFO sighting report, one of thousands compiled over the last few decades. This particular report from October 1969 was filled out by Jimmy Carter. He was still governor of Georgia at the time. He witnessed a luminous object suspended in a twilight sky. Later, when he assumed the office of President of the United States, his staff attempted to explore the availability of official investigations into alien contact. As this internal government memo illustrates, there are some security secrets outside the jurisdiction of the White House.
Outside the jurisdiction of the White House. If the President of the United States is the Commander-in-Chief of the entire U.S. military, just who can be outside the jurisdiction of the White House? Seriously. If the deep state does not exist, then who in the world are they referring to? March 22, 1950. This letter was sent to the director of the FBI. March 22nd, by the way, is 322. 322 is the calling card for the actual Skull and Bones secret society. Whether or not they have anything to do with this declassified document, well, your guess is as good as mine. Let's continue. On March 22nd, 1950, this letter was sent to the director of the FBI by a man named Guy Hotell. The letter reads as follows, quote, "An investigator for the Air Force stated that three so-called flying saucers had been recovered in New Mexico. They were described as being circular in shape with raised centers, approximately 50 feet in diameter. Each one was occupied by three bodies of human shape, but only 3 feet tall. Dressed in a metallic cloth of a very fine texture, each body was arranged in a manner similar to the blackout suits used by speed flyers and the pilots. According to Mr. Blank, informant, the saucers were found in New Mexico due to the fact that the government has a very high-powered radar setup in that area, and it is believed that that radar interferes with the controlling mechanics of the saucers. No further evaluation was attempted by Blank concerning the above." End quote. So there are people in the government who know something about the UAP phenomenon. But what about the private sector?
So if the United States government wanted to convince the public that extraterrestrials were visiting mankind, how would they do it? Behind me here, Skinwalker Ranch is the perfect way for them to do it. What they're doing, in my opinion, is preparing the public for something. Now, either it is fake and they're preparing the public for some sort of massive deception or psyop, or it's real and they're preparing the public for something that they know is underground that they will reveal at some point.
Leave the area. This area is under video surveillance and you have been recorded.
I'm here at Skinwalker Ranch. And I don't know if you've heard about this place before, but it's one of the most mysterious places on planet Earth. So, what is Skinwalker Ranch? And if you haven't actually been following the story, let me just bring you up to speed. The place behind me is one of the most mysterious places known to human beings, otherwise known as the Sherman Ranch. When the Sherman family moved in, they noticed a lot of weird things happening. And to make a long story short, they saw everything from literal werewolves who they shot multiple times and they ran away, monsters, UFOs hundreds of times, little blue balls that float around and seem to be intelligently controlled that ended up actually killing their dogs and incinerating them, little red balls that flew around and terrified their horses. They also had four black Angus bulls that were somehow, without any explanation, taken up from the corral and brought inside of the trailer while the family was sitting right outside. No noise was made. How are you going to take four 2,000 pound bulls and put them in a trailer? So when they went to the trailer, the bulls were kind of like in a daze, in a trance, just kind of sitting in there. And as soon as the family came up, the owners of the bulls, they came up, the bulls woke up out of their trance and started to panic. And the story goes that they actually destroyed the entire trailer. They stampeded and they went crazy. They were finally able to let them out, and the bulls were totally traumatized. So they just ran around destroying things for a while, and it took them a long time to get the bulls under control. Now, there's so many stories regarding the Sherman Ranch, and most of them are actually based on his word alone. But what about the NIDS and the OSAP team? Could they have been faking it? Absolutely, they could have been faking it. This whole entire thing could be a psyop. So a lot of people actually believe that Skinwalker Ranch is fake, and all of the stories that come out of here are a psyop from the government. Now, this would be highly reminiscent of the Paul Benowitz story. And if you're not informed with Paul Benowitz's story, basically this is what happened. Paul Benowitz was a physicist who saw UFO sightings and was telling people that, hey, these are aliens from a different world. So what happened was the government actually sent some intelligence agencies, namely the Air Force OSI, which is the Air Force's intelligence agency that, you know, does intelligence stuff for them. What they did was they actually tricked Paul Benowitz into believing that they were UFOs and that there was an alien base under Dulce, New Mexico. Let me just read the description for this story. 1978, Paul Benowitz, an electrical physicist living in Albuquerque, New Mexico, became convinced that strange lights he saw hovering in the night sky were extraterrestrials. He reached out to newspapers, senators, and even the president before anybody responded. Air Force investigators, they listened to his story, as did Bill Moore, the author of the first book of the infamous Roswell UFO incident. Unbeknownst to Benowitz, Moore was hired by a group of intelligence agents to keep track on Benowitz while Air Force ran a psychological profile on him. They also ran a disinformation campaign on the unsuspecting physicist. So here we have the United States Air Force running a disinformation psyop campaign on this one physicist, but to what end? In return, Air Force intelligence would let Moore in on classified UFO material. What follows is a scandalous true tale of disinformation, corruption, and exploitations, all at the hands of the United States intelligence community. So basically, the US intelligence community set their focus on Paul Benowitz and convinced him that there was aliens coming from another planet, when chances are that's not what happened. So why did they do this? I think it was for them to figure out how easy it would be to convince people of something. It's a lot easier than you think it is. All you have to do is give them little nuggets here and there and they believe it. So that brings us back to behind me here. We're at Skinwalker Ranch, and some people say the whole thing is fake. The whole thing is a hoax brought on by the government in order to convince people that aliens or extraterrestrials are visiting Earth. Now, what proof do we have that it's a hoax? We don't have any proof it's a hoax, but do we have any proof that it's real? Absolutely not. All of our proof comes from the Sherman family's testimony. That's the originator. That's where all of this stuff comes from. So, is it possible that the United States government worked with the Sherman family to maybe fabricate these stories in an attempt to convince the public of something that's happening here? I think it is possible. And furthermore, I think it's more than possible that if the US government wanted to convince people that there was aliens visiting Earth, they would have to do it in a way like this. They couldn't just come out and say it. There was a report that was made, I think it was in the 70s, that said if the American public found out about UFOs, found out that they are visiting from another planet, it would cause chaos. The report states that society would break down almost immediately. And if society breaks down, well, you know, there's no more money for them. So they can't have that. So what are they going to do? And we obviously know that they want us to believe the aliens come from another planet. They want us to believe that. Why?
The real question is, are the Shermans telling the truth about what happened on Skinwalker Ranch? I believe the answer to that question is yes. They are telling the truth. And the reason why I believe they are telling the truth is right behind me. We're at a place right now, right down the road from Skinwalker Ranch, called McConkie Ranch. Now, McConkie Ranch, all these walls behind me are filled with magnificent petroglyphs dating back hundreds, maybe thousands of years. What do these petroglyphs show?
in my opinion, and the opinion of a lot of other people, these petroglyphs basically tell a story carved in stone. Now, the story is almost the same as what we hear that went on at Skinwalker Ranch. So basically, we have a record carved in stone by the native people here on the rock faces behind me that tell almost the same exact story of what's happening and what happened at Skinwalker Ranch. You have portals, you have monstrous beings coming out of the portals. So it is my opinion that the petroglyphs here at McConkie Ranch behind me lend credibility to the whole Sherman Ranch, Skinwalker Ranch story. Because these things have been happening in this area for a very, very long time. So if it is real, what could be happening here? What could be the explanation behind all the crazy events? If the Shermans were telling the truth, Bigelow, his NIDS team, and the OSAP team are all telling the truth, and then furthermore, present times, Brandon Fogel and his team out here are telling the truth. If all of these people are telling the truth, what does that mean for us? Simple. So there's three distinct possibilities about what's really going on here. One, there's something buried under the ground that the government found out about during the OSAP and NIDS investigations, because a lot of that stuff is still highly classified. So first theory is that there's something buried under the ground and the government knows about it. And when I say something, I mean a piece of technology from thousands and thousands of years ago, from what we would call the antediluvian era. Yes, fallen angel technology. And whatever this is activating a wormhole or a portal and allowing these entities to come through. Now, is it at will? Is it random? Does it depend on the moon, the stars? Who knows, you know, because these things are very strange and it's really hard to even understand what's going on there if the stories are true. So if the stories are true and there is something buried under the ground here, what does that mean for us? It's simple. They want us to believe a certain thing about what they're going to find. They're going to publicize it. The people that are here right now have been chosen by the government to basically unveil this piece of antediluvian technology to the world. I believe they've been chosen by the government to release this information. I believe the government actually knows what's under there. They've done their tests. They know what's there. Now, remember a few years ago when Fox News came out with an article saying that the Pentagon has recovered, quote, off-world objects not made on this earth.
On July 23rd, 2020, Tucker Carlson shocked the world when he said this on his live Fox News broadcast.
This is a Fox News alert. There are new findings tonight in the search for extraterrestrial life. The New York Times reporting that a secretive Pentagon unit tasked with investigating UFO sightings is quite likely releasing some of its findings soon. But apparently, just recovered are off-world vehicles not made on this earth. That's a direct quote.
The following day, multiple articles were released going into more detail. The Intelligencer reports on July 24th, 2020, quote, "The Pentagon has reportedly found off-world vehicles not made of this earth." Also, Fox News releases an article entitled, quote, "With Pentagon UFO unit in the spotlight, reports mention off-world vehicles not made of this earth."
Off-world objects not made on this earth. That's exactly what I think is underground at Skinwalker Ranch. So if the government knows what's happening here, why don't they just come and take it? Well, it's simple. They already have plenty of these crafts. They don't need any more. We know they have recovered discs from Roswell. And if you don't believe me, why is it still classified, right? Does that make sense? If they said, hey, it's a weather balloon, why is it still classified? You think the weather balloon technology is still classified 75 years later? No, not at all. Here's what it is. They did recover flying discs in Roswell. And them keeping the information classified still reveals it, because they declassified stuff that doesn't matter. Go through all the old UFO reports from the 60s, 70s, 80s. A lot of that stuff is declassified. Why? Because it's meaningless. It doesn't matter. Roswell obviously does matter, so they kept it classified. So, in my opinion, the first news report that came out about Roswell is correct. So they have the craft recovered at Roswell. They have off-world objects not made on this Earth, according to Fox News. And Bob Lazar talks about his experience working with these crafts. So we know the government already has these things. They don't need any more. So why do they want the public to find out? It's simple. If they want to deceive the public about what's going on here, about what they've found, this is all they have to do. All they have to do is say, hey, look at these things. This is what they are. And then from there, they can use this crisis as a means to their end, right? It's the old Hegelian dialectic. Problem, reaction, solution. What is the problem? The problem is, oh, we have these UFO crafts buried under the ground. Reaction. Oh, we're not alone in this world. Oh, everybody, okay. Solution. So what is my opinion on Skinwalker Ranch? My opinion is that all of this is planned. My opinion is that the modern owner, Brandon Fogel, and everything that's happening on the show is orchestrated by the United States government in order to reveal something under the ground. Think about it. What's going to happen if on the History Channel, the Secret of Skinwalker Ranch TV show, some season finale, they unveil an actual off-world object not made of this earth, as reported by Fox News. They unveil an actual UFO. What would happen? I'll tell you what would happen. People would go insane. So, I think that's what they're going to do. I think the whole plan is disclosure. They want to reveal these objects to the public, but they want to do it in a way that is not threatening. And they believe, I think, putting it on TV is not threatening, so that's what they're going to do.
Dr. I.D.E. Thomas is one of a long line of Welsh preachers. He is currently the senior pastor at the First Baptist Church of Maywood, California, and has authored several books which have enjoyed wide circulation. In his book, The Omega Conspiracy, Dr. Thomas explains the phenomenon of unidentified flying objects and offers an explanation that could identify the beings who operate them. As incredible as his explanation may sound, let us regard the ancient saying of Heraclitus, who 500 years before Christ said, "Because it is sometimes so unbelievable, the truth escapes becoming known."
The answer to all this and the clue to this cosmic riddle may be found in the ancient book of Genesis. And back there in chapter 6, we are told of a very amazing and bizarre event. The sons of God saw the daughters of men and saw that they were beautiful, and they lusted after them. And then we read they married them and sired children from them. For the past 1500 years, most scholars, including evangelical scholars, have interpreted the sons of God as the good sons of Seth and the daughters of men as the wicked daughters of Cain. They've adopted that interpretation because the other one is so bizarre and outlandish. The ancient interpretation, and in my opinion the correct one, is that the sons of God were demonic beings or fallen angels, and that they came down to earth, they lusted after the daughters of men, they married them, and produced this amazing progeny, this hybrid progeny of the Nephilim. And the very word Nephilim does not mean giants. It comes from the root Nephal, fallen ones. The early Christian fathers, in the first four centuries, men like Irenaeus, Tertullian, Ambrose, for 400 years they knew no other interpretation except that the sons of God were angelic beings. Josephus, the cosmopolitan Jewish historian, says the same thing. We read in the book of Job that when God laid the foundation of the earth, the sons of God shouted for joy. Obviously, the sons of God could not be human beings. Adam had not been created. If this was a case of just mixed marriages between good men and wicked women, it is surprising that God should have issued the fiat of judgment that he did. God took this stern action of wiping out the human race. Now, the only family that were left intact in order to re-establish, repopulate the new world was the family of Noah. Noah, we are told, was perfect in his generations. The word perfect does not mean In this case, morally perfect. Because we know from the story of Noah, and especially what happened after the flood, that Noah was not perfect. What it means is, like a lamb for the paschal sacrifice, that lamb had to be without blemish. Physically pure, without blemish. So it seems with the case of Noah, the only family that remained uncontaminated from these strange beings that appeared from space. The only line that was pure and clean from God's standpoint to start a new world and a new civilization. Jesus said, as in the days of Noah, so in the days of the coming of the Son of Man. Of all the patriarchs and prophets of the Old Testament, the key to prophecy, above all others, is Noah. And something happened in the days of Noah that was a distinctive characteristic of Noah's time that didn't happen before or after. Wars and famines and pestilences and natural disasters have always happened. But something happened in the days of Noah, and the most sinister and bizarre of all the things that happened was this intermarriage between the angelic race and the human race. And of course, the mastermind behind it all was another angel, a fallen angel, Lucifer. Now we believe that as they came in those days, we may very well be on the edge of another invasion from outer space, that Satan will once again make another attempt, maybe the final assault on the human race, in order to wean men and women away from the worship of God. He has tried before, he will inevitably try again. And by seducing the human race, by sending these so-called entities from space, demonic beings, he will try to get people all over the world to worship him and to deprive God of the worship that is due to him. Fortunately, we know what the end result is going to be. But this final or omega assault that will come at the end of time.
I believe that the alien entities, the higher entities, they will likely use some type of a cataclysmic event, something major, whether it's real or synthetic. You know, we know about Project Bluebeam. We know about technology where they can project an image in the sky.
There's going to be things that come upon this earth that are going to cause men's hearts to fail them. And so, like right now, everybody is consumed with this Western civilization of idea of, you know, going to work and coming home and watching the ball game and getting married, 2.5 kids, dog and a cat, that whole deal. There's no room for supernaturalism there. But when that does take place, it's going to flip the world on its head. And so I think that this is kind of like we've already seen like a soft disclosure take place. And I think it's prepping the world for that. But even more so, I believe that it's tying into what the Bible says is going to take place. And ultimately, it's going to be pointing the world towards an antichrist, towards a false prophet promoting that antichrist. He's going to be able to call fire down from heaven. It's going to be some supernatural feats taking place in the eyes of men. And so if the world doesn't have a supernatural world view, that's going to give it to them. I think that all this is going to culminate pointing people to this so-called messianic figure that's going to be in the place of Christ.
Let's just go back in time. There was an event that took place back in the late 40s known as the Babylon Working Ritual. Now, this was a ritual that was carried out by Jack Parsons, JPL. You know, people will even to this day say that JPL stands for Jack Parsons Laboratories, but on paper, it's Jet Propulsion Laboratories. JPL is major. It's a historic, I mean, so much surrounding this, so much history here. Jack Parsons was not professionally trained, yet he was tapping into high technology and building rockets. How do you do that without any type of formal training? There were no rocket programs in America before Jack Parsons. This is paramount to understand. This guy was tapping into, you know, theosophy, Thelema, the religion of Aleister Crowley. He was a disciple of Aleister Crowley, and he was working with L. Ron Hubbard, who was the founder of Scientology. Interestingly, not only did L. Ron Hubbard start Scientology, but he was a science fiction writer. Mm-hmm. The movie Battlefield Earth with John Travolta, well, that was written by L. Ron Hubbard. Interestingly also, John Travolta is a Scientologist, right? Now, I mention this because this is a man who writes science fiction, yet he started a religion based on science fiction. There has to be something in there where he's getting these clues and these ideas. He's getting these from another realm.
From that point, you know, they ripped a hole open into space-time. And from that point afterwards, you had, well, regardless of what Parsons actually successfully completed during that with the Whore of Babylon and different things, after that, you had the Roswell incident. You had the Kenneth Arnold sightings. You had in 53, there was the swarm of UFOs that flew over the White House. And so there's this unleashing of supernatural activity that took place after that ritual was performed.
Babylon working was successful, according to Jack Parsons. Matter of fact, Parsons said in his Antichrist Manifesto that they were successful and that a child was conceived in that act, and that there was a spirit known as Hilarion. The Whore of Babylon was what they were trying to bring about. They believed what we believe, in that America was the final Babylon. Like, this was the revived Babylon. They believed it, and they were occultists. You know, we're Christians, and we believe it. There's evidence to back this up. But yes, let's backtrack just for a second. What happened was they opened up this portal. They created a rift. And entities began to come through, not just this Whore of Babylon being birthed, but other entities, because people all over the place started having paranormal encounters, and they began to report this to law enforcement, report this to the FBI, report this to whatever agency they could get in touch with. And so the federal agencies said, we've got to come up with an answer for this. You know, we were not prepared for any of this. There's UFO activity. There's talk of entities and demons and winged creatures and just all kinds of weird, I mean, just paranormal demonic activity following this ritual that Jack Parsons said finally worked. Wow. They did the ritual for a couple years. It finally worked, finally stuck. And that's what a scientist does. A scientist is going to work at something. He's going to work at that hypothesis. Absolutely. Until it's you know, proven true or false. Now, finally, the researchers, the government puts together this group that says, we're going to get answers to what exactly took place out there in the desert in California by Jack Parsons and L. Ron Hubbard. They go to Jack Parsons, and keep in mind, Jack Parsons is also working with the government. He's now been given, you know, special privileges on things. So they go to him, and they say, Jack, all of this stuff that's happening right now, did you do this? Did you do this? And, you know, he said, I think so. Now, shortly thereafter, Jack Parsons blows himself up in a lab. Accidental. It was not intentional. The occult belief was that whoever opened up the portal had to close the portal. Well, Jack Parsons is now dead. Wow. And the federal government is now having to understand and depict exactly to the public what's happening here. And so this group is researching, and out of that group, they finally start to make some headway. They know they're dealing with entities. And so in all of that, they begin to try to make contact with those entities, maybe for some help. Maybe because they're trying to figure out how to close this thing. Maybe they're trying to figure out how to undo what Jack Parsons did. So they go through satanic rituals to communicate, because that's the only method of communication that they know that works to contact these entities. In doing this, there's a small faction known as the Collins Elite.
Okay, who are the Collins Elite in real life? Well, they were made up of scientific, military, you name it, very, very high up government officials that were all gathering evidence to say that this UFO phenomenon was more paranormal and demonic than it was your traditional, you know, superior beings from other planets or ETs. And the more that they started to test their voice and their opinion, they could see that was not what the forces that were going to work against them. So they had to remain hidden, and they remained and kept hidden. They at one point were thinking about, supposedly, the way it's reported, they were so convinced this was a satanic invasion that they were going to force America to be a theocracy, to be a forced Christian nation, to get ready for a satanic invasion. That was what they were talking about. But they quickly saw that they were not going to gain ground in our own governments, and they were relegated to, you just go to the side. We have an agenda to push here. It ties in almost all of these conspiracy theories, or prophecies, biblical prophecies. I mean, certainly the book of Daniel, these things are not considered conspiracy theory, they're fact. And so, they will mix their seed with the seed of men, but it will not cling, just as iron does not mix with clay. That's not a conspiracy theory. That's God telling us what's going to happen. They will mix their seed with the seed of men. So that's the last great kingdom. So it does not take a genius to connect the dots to say, who is mixing their seed with us, and why is that the last final kingdom?